could see it in the movies and the paper and the TV news. Somebody's army is always on the move. There's gonna be a battle, the lines have been drawn. They got guns and tanks and planes. The wells are gone dry and the water is bad, and the air is acid rain. There's war after war and rumors of war from the east. There's a rumbling in the ground and they're talking about the beast.
Well, hello, hello. Welcome to Reports from Under the Desk. My name is Shel Wagner and I'm so glad you came to join me today, whether you're watching now or in the future. I pray that this broadcast is a blessing to you and that you receive the message within the message from our Heavenly Father that you need for your life. All right. Well, today is an exciting day and I've been looking forward to it for quite a while. And so has my ministry partner, Nurse Lee. Nurse Lee, welcome.
Shalom. So glad to be here. I am so glad you were excited about this today. Absolutely.
I am too. So I'm going to go ahead and bring on our guest, Dr. Alfonso Monzo. Welcome to Reports from Under the Desk.
Hello. Thanks for having me.
I'm so glad you're here today. I'm really excited about this. And you know, I just know that it's going to be a blessing for our audience. Now, for those who don't realize, Nurse Lee spent her career in the neonatal unit and an additional 11 years in home health care. So she kind of got to see the gamut of society and what goes on in people's lives and bodies and their choices and the outcomes. So that's why I really wanted her to be on with us today. And Dr. Monzo has a practice in Medina, Ohio. His clinic is called Wellbeing by Design. And I'm going to, when I get done a little further in the show, I'll run a ticker across that's got the website so that everybody can find his ministry and clinic. And he is a naturopath physician. And actually, since I began to have major health problems, he is the 14th doctor that I have worked with in the last 8 years. So it's been amazing. It's really been an amazing journey. So I just wanted to give the audience just a little background before we're going to go over what's called the quest for or quest for. I'm not even sure I'm saying it right.
It's quest, even though there's no you.
Got it.
It's the phonics, quest for, of course.
Yeah, diagnostic report. And so what's amazing is I didn't have to go into the office. I didn't have to make a trip to Ohio. And yet Dr. Monzo and I are working together to improve my health while I'm in North Carolina and he is in Ohio. When I turn it over to him, I'm going to let him tell you a little bit more about the message, the type of practice that he has with energy medicine. It's amazing to me. I mean, it has just blown my mind what all can be done remotely, you know? So just to let everybody know, I just want to tell you a little bit about my story in case you don't know. I was a chronic alcoholic for 30 years. When I first began to try to get sober, I was 23 years old. I had 1 year of sobriety, and I remember asking my mother, when did I start to drink? I can't remember. And she said, oh, honey, from the time that you could walk, your dad thought it was funny to see you in that condition. And so no wonder I couldn't remember. I just knew that I drank all my life, and I couldn't remember starting. Fortunately for me, there was a little church bus that came to my neighborhood when I was around 7-8 years old. And I took that little church bus and I visited the Baptist church and I learned who Jesus was and I made a decision and I gave my life to him and became baptized. And I believe, despite the fact that my life was filled with trouble, he was with me every step of the way and he knew what my story would be. And he is an amazing redemptive father that loves us completely. And I look at my life and the choices I make. I can tell you, as an alcoholic woman, there were not many things that I didn't do on the side of sin. I really put myself out there, you know. And even though I had made that decision as a little girl and the environment that I was in, I can see where that story from Mark 4 was so powerful in my life, that the word is given, but the enemy sends somebody to try to snatch it as fast as possible. And that was the environment that I lived in, if you could see the environment that I was being raised in. And that's what happened to me. And so it hardened my heart. It took me a while, but no matter where I went, there was that deep innate knowing that Yah was still with me, that his Ruach was still with me. You know, he was always with me. And when I became willing, which was at the point when my child died, I had gotten sober at 23. I stayed that way for 3 years. I had a child, and then I relapsed and got pregnant. And that child died, and I could not stay sober while I was pregnant, and she died at 2 months old. So I had a ton of guilt and shame, not just from my lifestyle, but then as my choices, as I was trying to get, you know, sober. So after she did, it did bring me to a new place of relationship and humility, where I did sincerely ask Yah to come into my life and help me. And he did. And I was able to stay sober about 11 years. And then major things happened in my life, and I relapsed for another 2.5 years. Today, and last September, I just celebrated 14 years of being drug and alcohol free. Now, with all these things, though, and those choices, you make really bad choices when you're an alcoholic for your health, for your finances, for your relationships. I mean, you make really bad decisions underneath those kind of influences, right? And so I can tell you that Yah has done amazing things to deliver me from mindsets that were hindering me. And I'm so grateful for everything that he's done in my life. Yet my body still bears all of the trauma, right? And so around 2014, I got bit by a brown recluse spider. At that point, my health was like it fell off of a cliff. It felt like something just tipped over in my system, and suddenly everything started going wrong. It was affecting everything from my hair falling out to my vision to problems with my teeth, to breathing problems, to mental clarity, to exhaustion, to aches and pains all over, to, you know, swelling and inflammation. I mean, it was just crazy. It was just like it had tipped over. So I went through conventional medicine, because that's what I knew to do at that point. So that was in 2014. Led me to a rheumatologist. It took me 18 months to get to the point of the rheumatologist deigning to give me 10 minutes of his time, in which time he told me that I had fibromyalgia, at which time I was so frustrated that I said, listen, at least I know enough to know that that is a symptom and not a root cause of anything. You've told me nothing. At which point he suggested that maybe I had more mental problems than physical, and perhaps I needed to see a psychiatrist because I wasn't believing the great doctor. So that was not a good experience. So the primary care physician decided that what I needed was high dose vitamin D. So since from 2014 all the way to last February, when I interviewed Dr. Monzo for the first time, I took high dose vitamin D. When we were on the interview last time, he had told me that's not a good choice. And so I stopped doing that, right? So, but it was amazing. That was the one thing they gave me. And then they wanted me on all kinds of psychiatric medications, and I rejected all of them. I went, I know that is not the issue. You know, I just know. And so then I started seeking out other doctors. The first one I went to was called a functional medicine doctor. when I couldn't afford all the, I afforded what I could afford. She did let me know I had mold, right? She kept me on high dose vitamin D. She wanted me to do ozone treatments. I did those. She wanted me to go have all the mercury removed from my teeth. I did that. I had ozone shot into my mouth. I did all these things. I sat in the saunas. I did the PIMF machine. I had the chiropractic adjustments. I did everything they told me to do until I ran out of money, at which point she told me to go home and build a sweat lodge in my backyard because maybe that would help me. And I was actually trying to do it because I had that much brain fog. A few years later go by and I am still in a mess. And so I go to a integrative physician. They send me for acupuncture. They do all kinds of things. They're giving me high dose medicine for Epstein-Barr. You know, yes, they say I've got mold. I mean, they're just throwing hormones at me and this, that, and the other. And still high dose vitamin D. I did that. You know, still for years, you know, I just saw no improvement. I've done detox after detox after detox. Every one of them has made me deathly ill. I have felt so much worse. So just know that through 13 doctors until Dr. Monzo, that story was just rinse and repeat, rinse and repeat, rinse and repeat, no matter who I saw or what I tried. So at that point, I have now had my quest from Dr. Monzo done, and I am now on his protocol. So Dr. Monzo, with that bit of background, I want to turn it over to you.
Yeah. Well, there's so many things we can talk about now.
That's right.
But I guess the first things first, we should talk a little bit about the clinic.
Yeah. Yeah.
And how we do our testing. So let me see here. Sorry, I'm just trying to bring up my screen.
No problem. While you're doing that, I'm going to show everybody Dr. Monzo's book. This is how I came to know about Dr. Monzo, was through his book, The Olive Top Body System. I had ordered it from my friend Nitza Moshe of Remnet Remedy because she was so excited about the work that Dr. Monzo was doing and she recommended it. And so I got that and started digging in. And then I wanted to do an interview with him last year. So...
All right. Well, I think it's up on the screen.
So, let me add it to the screen for you.
Okay.
There we go.
There we go. I think I have multiple screens myself. So, okay. I don't want to move that over there. So our ministry is called Health Restoration Ministries now. And we are a private ministerial association. And the main type of testing we do, we actually have two different testing devices. The main one is the Quest 4. Which you can see up here. And then there's another one that's a little bit more for therapy, but it does do testing too. And that's the QI5. So what you need to do is first understand how the body really works. So in biology and, maybe anatomy, physiology, pathology, they're going to teach this little chart here called the levels of structural organization. And it's going to be everything in the white. And they're going to start from the deepest level, which is only really level number 2, the chemistry level, right? And they're going to say chemicals come together to form cells. Cells come together to form the tissues. Tissues form organs. The organ systems come together to form the organ, or organs come together to form the organ systems. And then all the organ systems come together forms the organism, which is you. The problem with this model is they forget the very first level, which is the informational level of the body. You could call this the electromagnetic system of the body. You can call it information. You can call it software, but it's the unseen level of the body. And that's what controls everything. And most of the functions, well, I wouldn't say most, I would say almost all the functions in the body are actually performed by light communication of information and energy throughout the body. So you have information to tell the body how to do things, and you have active energy to power the different systems of the body. And this is a system that they don't want to talk about in modern medicine, and there's a lot of reasons for that. One, obviously, it completely does away with the idea of this evolution nonsense. Because once you get to the informational level, well, who has all the information and all the power? So we don't just have random chemicals floating around the body, accidentally bumping into each other. They know exactly what to do because there's a software controlling them. When you go one more level deep, then you find out that there's what my book's written about is the Aleph Tav body system, which is the Hebrew letters are literally on the body, and they're like telecommunication systems. And each Hebrew letter contains all the information for life related to what that Hebrew letter is related to. And those points then are directly connected to the Creator. And as they're resonating and circulating properly, they are sending the information throughout the body so the body can manifest and recreate itself correctly. Now, when these points get messed up, then we start having all kinds of problems in the body. And they're directly connected to His word and the meaning of His letters. So our lifestyle and everything we do directly affects how these letters function and how the communication between us and the Creator is functioning. I'm going to skip this real quick. We're not actually going to watch that. This explains a little bit more, again, how it all works on the informational level. So the Creator provides us the breath of life. And so one of the big things I would always teach is electromagnetism seems to be this glue between the physical world and the spiritual world. It's like Jacob's ladder. You see these angels ascending and descending, and when people get really big into SRA, the occult, witchcraft, and you start dealing with where they build their temples and their sacred shrines, where they do their blood sacrifices, it's always on all these grid lines. And when people really get into clearing out houses and different things, you'll find that there's a definite affinity for evil spirits to like to be connected to electromagnetic things. And I think that's because electromagnetism is that glue between the physical and the spiritual.
Do they call that sometimes ley lines?
Yep.
Okay.
Ley lines, they're called the Hartman grid lines, the Curry grid lines, the ley lines. These are naturally occurring electromagnetic grid of the Earth. And when you really think about it, we're just dust, you know, we're dirt. How do you take a lump of clay and make it so that it's animated and living and can house a spirit and a soul? Well, I think that's the electromagnetism, which is what gives the matter the energy and the information to be able to live and then house a spirit. So that's why in the occult world, you see so much to do with the very same things I talk about, because they have to copy everything the Creator created for them to manipulate the physical world. So they don't want you knowing about a lot of this stuff because it's exactly what they're doing.
You know, it reminds me, one of my favorite scriptures is talks about how it's in the Savior, in Mashiach, that we live and we move and we have our being. That really gives that a different perspective, doesn't it?
Yes. Yeah, and that's why we get caught up on all this stuff like acupuncture and meridians and chakras, and there's all these big debates and everyone, oh, it's all New Age, it's all this. Well, it's all Yah stuff. This is all about light and force and movement and physics. But the enemy comes along and takes it all and twists it.
Wow. I can see in the chat, I know my friend Nina's putting up a question. So I'm going to tell you guys what I'd like to do is I want to let Dr. Sure. Monzo give his presentation. And then at the end, if we have time for questions, I'll announce it. And you guys can put all your questions in caps so I can find them. Okay.
So just remember, matter does not matter to energy. The energy makes the matter. So when we get to the testing, it's all about electromagnetic communication. This is how the body really works. So what a Quest 4 device is able to do, and there's two ways to use it. One way is for the person to physically be here and be touching two electrodes, which is then going to use a small current to either measure different frequencies in the body or output a frequency and see how the body reacts. Now, so you're basically communicating with the body. We call it a form of biofeedback, but it's using energy signatures. And the other way then is if you're not physically present, we can disconnect the electrodes and we have a test plate where we can put the person's DNA. And we can test the person's DNA the same way as if they're physically here.
Can I ask you a quick question on that?
Yes.
Because I had gotten an email from you and in it was like, it was right after my latest scan, right? And so not the first scan, but then like a follow-up scan. And in the email, it was like, I can see you're feeling better. And I thought, can you tell that now from the original DNA? Is that still so connected to me that you can tell on a scan how I'm progressing in treatment?
With your original DNA?
Right.
Yes, for a while.
Okay.
It will last for so long. And this is called quantum entanglement. Wow. So in Christian circles, we would talk about soul ties.
Wow.
Where the life is in the blood. And so the military figured this out a long time ago, and they call it quantum entanglement, that your DNA is always connected to you wirelessly. And whatever happens to the DNA is what's happening to your body at the same time. It's like a mirror image. So when we're testing a person's DNA, we're actually testing that person in real time, wirelessly. And see, what the military did is that they took soldiers that came back from war who were traumatized, and they took their blood and put it under a microscope with an oscilloscope on it, which can measure, the frequency and different electromagnetic spikes. And then they put the soldiers in a room and show where they could watch a movie, and they would show them these wartime films that would trigger an mental emotional response because they have post-traumatic stress. And what they found out is every time the person reacted, their blood would react exactly at the same time. And what they did is they started taking the blood further and further away. So it was in another room, and then across the country, and then of course across the world. But still, no matter how far away they took the DNA, the DNA would react the exact same time the person reacted.
That is incredible.
And that's how they found out that your DNA is always directly connected to you.
Wow.
And that's why, you can use these principles for good. You can use them for bad. It's like a hammer, right?
I was just fixing to say, we've seen other countries want to obtain DNA.
Yes.
And that now makes a whole nother, makes sense to me on a whole nother level.
Yeah.
Well, because I've been thinking, why would they want that?
Yeah. And why do they use it in the occult for, what's that thing with little dolls?
Oh, voodoo.
Voodoo.
Yeah.
They usually have to get a sample from the person.
That's right. Hair, right? Or something like that.
Right? Ooh. So yeah. It's like a hammer. It's like you can build a house with a hammer or you can kill someone.
Right.
Wow.
So it's a tool. It doesn't necessarily mean it's bad. It's just, this is the way it is. And this is why we can create soul ties with other people, because the Hebrew word for life in the blood is the soul is in the blood. And I don't think we really quite understand this sometimes. So getting back to this now, you can see that this is just a little slide, and then we're going to kind of move on because we have all this other stuff to talk about on energetic signatures versus frequencies. We're technically testing energetic signatures. Now, we use the word frequency very generically in this country. We use it for energy. We use it all kinds of things, right? But technically, a frequency is a measurement of cycles per second. So it's not really true to say everything has a frequency. I mean, that's not wrong. But someone who's really scientific is going to have a problem with that, because it's like, that's not really good language. it's just like we use the word energy all the time over here. In Europe, a lot of times they use the word radiation. Now, we think of radiation as something bad, but the reality is down here in this little picture is a small picture of the electromagnetic scale. And in that scale, everything on this chart, which is everything that exists, is a form of either non-ionizing radiation or ionizing radiation. And they use radiation interchangeably with the word energy. Okay. So what we really do with an energetic signature is it's like this fingerprint up here. Because think of it this way, hydrogen and oxygen. Hydrogen has a frequency, oxygen has a frequency. But when they come together and you get H2O, you now have water. Well, right. Water now is made up of at least three molecules that we know of. You know, there's possibility there's stuff we don't know.
Right.
So there's at least three frequencies that now come together to create water. That becomes an energetic signature, which is like an energetic fingerprint. So that fingerprint is made up of all the little frequencies that make up that structure. And it's what sets that substance apart from all other substances. Only water has the energetic signature for water. Wood has the energetic signature for wood. Mercury has its own energetic signature, which is like an energetic fingerprint. So if we can measure those energetic signatures, we can tell what's in the body or how something affects the body, because there's only one thing that has that type of energetic fingerprint.
Wow.
So if we find the energetic signature of mercury in the body, we know that it's physically there. So I am going to just end this here real quick. And let me go. Well, that can stay up there for a second. And then what happens? So when we're doing a scan, the main thing usually is scanning the body to see what's in the body, what energetic signatures are showing up. That's one of the main ways. And when it finds something, then it will give us a dilution. And the dilution tells us how physically present it is in the body. If it's a very physical dilution, we know it's physically present. And if we did a lab with chemistry, we'd find it. And then there's a really energetic dilution, which tells us that your body has a memory that you were exposed to it, but it's not physically in the body anymore. I see your body remembers everything that has been done to it or that it was exposed to, unless you can erase that stuff out. So our body is literally housing all this information.
Right.
You know, water can store memory. And this is very commonly known in electrical engineering and other things. We have, everyone's looking at a computer screen right now, which is probably a liquid crystal display.
Mm-hmm.
Liquid crystal. So we have liquid crystal in our body. It's called structured water in your cells. And so your cells can hold all kinds of memory of all kinds of things that happened to it or that it's been exposed to.
Wow.
So this makes it really nice when things are coming up on a report, because we can tell, is it physically present or is it just a memory that you were exposed to it? Now, the other two ways we test is like the organs you're going to see here on this chart. We test the energetic signature for cardiovascular system, and then we can get a number on a scale of how healthy it is. Is it really weak? Is it really stressed? Is it balanced? And we have a scale that Dr. Voll came up with almost 80 years ago now, where he figured out how healthy each cell in the body or tissue in the body was supposed to be based on he called it the Voll scale, which is a mathematics scale based on voltage and current and resistance. And he figured out a range of healthy tissues and the range for tissues that are under stress and inflammation versus a range where tissues are under exhaustion phase, where there's very low cell energy.
Right.
So we can get a range for all the tissues of the body. And then that's what tells us, okay, what systems are the most stressed? What systems are the most weak? What systems are currently in homeostasis, balance, right? And then the third thing we can do is we can output the signature of different substances, like different substances, different supplements, different minerals, and find out which ones balance you the best and bring those organs back in proper alignment. And That's what Dr. Voll was, a German scientist, and he was one of the first ones that really proved that there were energy systems in the body about 80 years ago. So he started measuring acupuncture points with a ohm meter, which is an electrical device we use in electrical engineering all the time. Some people now call it a multimeter, but it can measure resistance. And he found out that every time he went to an acupuncture point, there was 100 times more resistance than non-points.
Wow.
Now, you know, when you do that a couple hundred times, you sit there and go, huh, there's clearly something different at these points. And then what they did is he teamed up with a French doctor, and they actually started injecting radioactive isotopes into acupuncture points and non-acupuncture points. And of course, what happened was the radioactive isotopes would flow along these channels when they injected them into acupuncture points. And they mapped them out. And guess what? They were like 90% accurate to the Chinese drawings. Huh. But when they injected them into non-points, it dissipated and went nowhere. So this is how almost 80 years ago we proved there absolutely are these energy systems in the body. And people can poo-poo it all they want, but it's like, well, you only have two options. Either Yah created these, or somehow Satan snuck down here and created the system on everyone's body to deceive them. And it's like, well, that second idea is beyond dumb.
Right.
It's like, no, he didn't sneak down here and create these systems. We can measure them. We can see them with the right type of photography and with radioactive isotopes. So they exist. And then there's deeper systems, which is what the Alaptop body system is all about. Because acupuncture is really a superficial system. And a lot of people believe that acupuncture is just the liquid crystals found in your fascia. And the energy travels from one liquid crystal to another in the fossa. So you're literally transferring information via light through liquid crystal that's in your fascia system.
What's the fascia system?
It's a form of connective tissue that's over top of your muscles.
Okay.
And we call that fascia.
Okay.
It almost looks like a white spider web material. Huh. So if you ever see like someone dissecting a muscle, and you have that white fibrous stuff that holds the muscle together, that surrounds the muscle, that's the fascia.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Now, the interesting thing he found when he was doing this is he was getting into all the supplements and stuff. And then he found something very strange. He would be measuring people's points, and then he kept noticing the reading would change. So he started paying attention, and he started realizing that when he was measuring a person's point and they grabbed one of his supplements, the reading would change and the point would come back into balance or get worse based on what the person picked up. So he realized that our body was communicating with the outside world electromagnetically. And when we put a new electromagnetic field inside our body's field, it would cause a shift. And he was able to start predicting what supplements would balance a person by them picking up different ones and seeing if they balance the points that were out of balance.
And is that kind of what that muscle type testing, mm-hmm. is it based on that?
Basing doing the same thing.
Okay.
Yeah, because muscle testing is based on the very fundamental principle of a lie detector test. Okay. Where subconsciously, your body knows the difference between a lie and a truth. And lies weaken the muscles, and truth makes the muscles stronger. And that's measured as a positive and a negative signal. So you see a polygraph test, it's going positive and negative. So when they make a statement and the person lies, what happens? It goes either positive or negative. And so what we know is if a person's lying about something, their muscles go weak and it's a negative signal that the device is picking up.
Okay.
So the same thing happens with you. If you pick up a supplement that's really good for you, it's going to make your muscles stronger because that's truth. Okay. If you pick up poison, your muscles are going to go weak. And that's all the person's doing is applying pressure to the muscle to see if it's still strong or weak based on what electrical signal is now being released from the brain. And it only happens for, you know, a couple seconds, and then the body's back into homeostasis and back to balance. So that's kind of how these devices were developed. And, you know, we're more than 80 years away from Voll. So now we have way more advanced testing where the person doesn't actually have to sit there and we don't have to test point by point anymore. So that's how the Quest 4 testing works. And let me bring up something here. So I think people can read that, right?
It's a little small.
It's a little small. Let me see what I can do about that. Well, it's okay. This is just for demo. So a typical scan, we usually call them scans. It's really a whole test. A typical comprehensive test with the DNA is usually about an hour and a half. So if a person comes in person, it's probably going to be a 2-hour appointment. And so there's multiple little scans during that hour and a half. So the first one we call the comprehensive. The comprehensive goes through a baseline of your organs to find which are weak or stressed. And then it goes through a list that I'm showing you of all these different things, but it's only looking at it. It can look at things three different ways. And this test is looking at causal only. So it's only going to bring something up on the report if it's part of the cause to your health problems. And I just wanted people to get an idea. The comprehensive scan, or this first one, is probably about 5-10 minutes. And then we do a supplement scan. And then we do an informational scan. Now, the informational scan gives you all kinds of information about the body. Might not be cause, but it's information. Like, what are your different misalignments? How do your teeth look? What do the hormones look like? What type of mineral deficiencies do you have? How does the energy systems look? All these things that are informational. They could be causal, they might not be. But we want to know that type of information. And then most people, we get into some type of chemical scan where we're looking at how well can the body detox and does it need to detox? We're looking at infectious scan, which includes the weaponized pathogens, and usually a cell scan that's looking at iron copper metabolism and what's going on inside the cell. Those are the fundamental tests that almost everybody gets. Now, based on this first scan, that's the causal, might direct us to do additional scans. And if you can read this, this is what is going to be going through in the first 10 minutes of your testing. And each one of these is a category. So this is hundreds of thousands of signatures. So this is amino acids, anti-aging filter, antibodies, bacterias, bioavailability. That's how well your body is using nutrients, cell permeability, how well the cells are absorbing, cell salts, chemicals, heavy metals. This is chromosomes, circulation, colors, constitutional remedies, critical issues. Now, when you open this up, it will show individually everything in each one of these categories.
Wow.
So just to let people see, in the first 10 minutes, we are going through all of this stuff to see which one of these things is a direct cause to your body. And as you can see, we can scroll down through this for a very, very, very long time.
Wow, that is incredible.
That's amazing.
So yeah, we're going through all amazing. These things. So that's why if I go back just to categories, you can see critical issues are like, do you have a mental emotional problem subconsciously that says you don't deserve to be healthy?
Right.
Are you dehydrated? Is there something that's critical that's stopping you from healing? It's going to go through teeth, dietary, digestive problems, drainage problems, electrolyte problems, enzymes, fatty acids. I mean, you just go down genome, heavy metals, geopathic, hormone imbalances, inflammation. Here's meridians, mental emotional frequencies, the mesenchyme, which we can't get into all this, metabolic issues, miasms, minerals, muscle skeletal, mycoplasmas. So you start getting into those type of things, oxidative stress, parasites. I mean, you name it, scar tissue. Here's all the weaponized stuff, the allotop body stuff, venoms, biological warfare, all the stuff, directed energy weapons, spiritual issues, you know, all the stuff that typically people don't think about. And the great thing about this type of scan is you can put all this stuff in here. And then, you know, you don't ever have to really think about it again. When you scan, you're going through all these different categories and you're finding out what is directly related to the person on a causal level. Now, any one of these scans, we could go and do a separate scan just on that if we really needed to. And you see right in here is where it will pick one out of each one of these categories. It says the number one causal priority of health problems is, and it will pick something out four times, and then it will say if you need any more. And we go up to maybe seven. And then it will pick out 4 to 7 therapies that would be the best for you. So from that very first scan, we have a very good understanding of where we need to go in the body.
That's amazing.
It is amazing.
And that's why I think this type of testing is so needed, because the bottom line is everybody's different.
Yeah.
Everyone has had their own traumas and their own mental, emotional, and physical environment they've been exposed to, different exposures. So you never know what you're going to find in a person. I mean, I've had the craziest stuff that you can imagine show up, and sometimes people never have a clue. You know, maybe they have food poisoning and don't realize it because, you know, maybe the food poisoning wasn't bad enough to send you to the hospital. But you got food poisoning, and ever since then, it's been enough to throw off your digestive system. And then what happens? You go to all the medical doctors. They can't figure it out. They probably make it worse with antibiotics. And the whole time you might have a food poisoning that they just can't get to.
Right.
Or maybe you got bit by something that transmitted something into the body. Or maybe you have heavy metals. Or maybe radon shows up on the scan. And I've had people where radon showed up really physical. And then they checked their house. And sure enough, they had a radon leak.
Wow.
So, you know, you just never really know. But this type of testing is really great because you get to really find root cause.
That's amazing.
And you don't have to guess. And as far as accuracy, typically I see this device is about 97 to 98% accurate. So you're not going to get anything even close. I was looking at a Harvard study not long ago, and they were saying if you only have one type of medical test done, it's about 20% accurate at diagnosing you. Then even to get into the 70%, you need to at least have 7 different types of medical tests ran on you. And it's like, how many people are even getting 7? Maybe 3?
Well, who can afford it?
Who can afford it?
Exactly.
Right. So this is your, this is how the report first starts looking. And it's giving you the baseline of your organs. So let me just skip down real quick so people can see. Yeah, you see this chart down here? This is the one that's important. And you're not being friendly to me. So this is the VOL chart. And you see that all these organs that are being tested are supposed to be perfectly at 50.
Right.
50 would be perfectly balanced, perfect homeostasis. And as long as it's in the green range, we would call that the first level of stress. You have stress in your life, but you're managing and you're keeping your homeostasis. When you move out of that range into the red range, this is the stressed range. And you can see down there, it says inflammation.
Right.
If I can get it to go down without going to the next page. Oh, it's not going to. Bad computer. Yep, it's just going to play with me. Well, you can kind of see it. So this would be phase 2 of stress. So now your body is not handling the stress anymore, and you're starting to get inflamed. You could call it overactive. And it's going to build and build and build and build. And eventually, your body's only going to be able to handle so much, and it's going to crash, and it's going to enter the third phase, which is the yellow, the weakened state. And it's going to start at a higher number, but it's going to start working its way down as the cells continue to lose energy until they're dysfunctional.
You know, what's amazing
to me, that's called the exhaustion phase.
what's amazing to me about that is thinking about, you know, that diagnosis, even the functional medicine doctor came up with, and it puts a label on you, which basically says there's not much you can do about it or not much hope. And that is SIRS, chronic inflammatory response syndrome. So, you know, it's like even in that world, if you're not working with the right person, you know, you can get some really bad labels put upon yourself.
Yes.
Takes your hope away.
Yeah.
Makes you feel like there's nothing that you can do, that you're outside of the realm of wellness.
I felt that way, you know, between everything going through. If I look at my personal journal over this 8 years, I have had to repent over and over again for getting to the point of being so discouraged that I was like, it's okay with me if you just take me out, y'all. I don't see how I can go on like this. I look and there is entry after entry after entry to where I just can't take it anymore. And I'm losing hope. I'm, you know, within that period and having to pray and ask and, you know, please help me just want to stay in this world.
Now, before getting tested, what was your two major symptoms that you would say you had complained about?
I would say exhaustion, would be the number one, and just widespread pain, you know, it is the next one.
So then you see 90 is a high number.
Yeah.
So circulation was really inflamed. Connective tissue is inflamed, and that makes up, you know, your joints and all that kind of stuff. Okay, so next is liver. It was really weak. Yeah. Well, not really weak, but it's on the weak side. So right. This means long-term stress to the liver. And you were saying that you've done all these detoxes, not really doing much.
Right.
Sinuses, inflamed. Look at this, the skeletal system, really weak.
Yeah.
Well, we can get into that in the vitamin D and what vitamin D really does to people, because it's not a vitamin. We'll get to that. Your stomach, not real bad. It's starting to get a little inflamed there. And then you're going to get thyroid, which has a lot to do with energy and metabolism. Well, it's 33. It's really weak.
Yeah.
So you're fatigued. And I think that was the organs. And then it kind of comes through comprehensive and it says, okay, there were cell salts, there was chemicals. These were all the things that showed up on that comp scan. And it's going to tell you, okay, there's problems with these areas. But then we get to something I call the detail summary report. Let's back it up a little bit because it's showing pretty good there. And really, this is where we spend most of our time with people, because everything we test kind of goes onto the detail summary page. So you're going to have your organs in order now. The one that was the weakest was thyroid energy. Skeletal system was the second weakest, and then the liver. And then you start getting into the ones that were inflamed. So lowest numbers, highest numbers. And I think stomach was the one that was like 57. So that's pretty close, because the cutoff is right at 55.
Yeah.
And then it's going to tell you what the toxin burden level was for the different categories. And you can see a level 10 was chemical heavy metals. And then you have the rest of the chemical section. You have the infection section. Over here, you have Aleph Tav body. Then you have the nutritional. And a lot of these will direct you to another page. It will tell you how many, and it directs you to the nutrition page. And then on the nutrition page, things will be highlighted that were not right. So the next one you see is hormones, endocrine. Other causes, and then therapies, and then, the green one is the big one. Because in the green, health priorities causal, this is where it picked out four or seven, and it picked out seven for you, main causes for your health problems. They're not necessarily in order. At the top, it says everything's in order, but not always. We just know these are the top seven things. Unbound iron. Oh, we can get into that one. Unbound iron is a major issue. You can see you had a physical structure issue and it was a misalignment. And if you come up, you can get to misalignments. Stop that computer. Gut microbiome. Number four is detox with methylation. And that explains a lot.
Yeah.
And then the Alaftab body energy system, metabolism. Well, metabolism is always going to be messed up if there's unbound iron. So the unbound iron gets into the copper iron metabolism. And if that's not right, then you're going to have metabolic issues and you're going to have problems specifically with the thyroid. And then the last category was the weaponized pathogens and nanotechnology nonsense. So, well, it's interesting because with your history, were you someone who was able to handle your alcohol pretty well?
Well, I had a high capacity. I could drink, you know, once I started to drink, there was no off button. It was just like pedal to the metal. But I remember at one point drinking round the clock 10 days straight and never sleeping at one point in my life.
Because see, normally, this is a good sign of a methylation problem. Is if a person has a really hard time with drugs and alcohol, meaning, you know, you take three sips and you're getting woozy. That's a good sign because the methylation genes control your phase two liver detox. So when methylation genes get turned off, you can't detox very well. So this probably tells me that the methylation genes probably were not turned off when you were younger.
Yeah.
And methylation genes are called genes that fall under epigenetics. That means they're genes that can be turned on and off by lifestyle, environment, mental, emotional. So based on our lifestyle, we can get these genes turned off. Now, sometimes they are passed on from the parents, but in your situation, they might not have been. And I tell you, one of the things I noticed that turns off a lot of methylation genes these days, high dose synthetic D.
Wow.
Okay. So let me just see. I think tank 2022. Let's see. I want to show you. Excuse me. Where is it opening it? image, I guess, is fine. If that's mine. Yes. So this is one of the charts I made.
Okay.
So people can see this is what the methylation cycles look like. And these little, there we go. These little boxes in the purple are the different methylation genes. Now, typically they say there's five cycles in methylation. You have the first one is the folate cycle. It's right here. And then you have the methionine cycle, the transsulfuration cycle down here. This is the urea. Or neural transmitter cycle. Over here is the urea, or also called nitric oxide. And those are the five typical ones. I think there's actually seven. I think the Krebs cycle is also part of one, and there's something down here that's a light control cycle that I'm still working on. And this is where you have your retinol and your D receptors. And they're both activated by light. D is made by light. But retinol has to be activated by light, and no one wants to talk about the retinol. They only want to talk about the D. We can get into that a little bit more. But what happens is these genes, it all starts here with the folate cycle. You notice with the folate cycle, you have arrows that go both ways.
Mm-hmm.
And the whole idea of the folate cycle is to take folate, which is B9, and methylate it and turn it into a methylated B9 and a methylated B12. And then this cycle passes on a methyl group both ways. And a methyl group is just one carbon and three hydrogen. And that's the whole purpose. But when you have, and this is why a lot of people talk about the MTHFR gene, that's because this gene can affect all the other genes because it affects things both ways. These genes make enzymes. And then these enzymes help break down substances and use substances in the body. So you'll notice there's a B9 here and a B12 here. So if some of these genes are turned off, guess what you can't do? Your body can't use B9, it can't use B12 in a non-methylated form because these genes methylate them, which means if you take a B9 or a B12, it has to be a methylated form because your body can't do it.
Wow.
And then when you get down, you know, you get over here, you have problems. You get over here, you start getting into homocysteine, and you can start getting into histamine reactions, taurine, glutathione. So your body might not even be able to make it if you have a methylation problem. That gets down into here, you start having problems with sulfates and sulfites, and you start seeing there's hormones down here that your body might not be able to make correct. So in this section, you're going to have problems with B vitamins. You're going to have problems with detox. You're going to start having problems with the gut. Over here, you're going to start having problems with overreactions and making antioxidants. Eventually, you're going to start having problems with sulfates and hormones and blood pressure. See this? Mm-hmm. Angiostatin or tension. Angiostatin 1 and 2. So you can have blood issues when you start getting down in here. And this one, you have neurological problems because now your body's not able to take these two amino acids and turn them into serotonin and dopamine. You want to know about most of the clinically diagnosed depression, anxiety? A lot of depression out there is people who have a methylation problem, and they don't check methylation genes in the medical field because the insurance companies don't think it's important, and it costs a lot of money. So most doctors aren't going to check it.
Right. What about Parkinson's and Alzheimer's and dementia as well? I was reading or watching several of your other discussions, and I can tell you in home health, seeing just a huge rise in that, and younger, early onset, they call it, and even Lewy bodies dementia, I saw quite a bit, and I wonder how much this plays a role in that.
Absolutely. Because you see, if it comes down with the tryptophan one, you're making serotonin, and then you can start making 5-HTP and glutamate and GABA. All that's going to be related. And this way comes down this way too. But this side is dopamine. And then that can come over here, and there's all kinds of things you can make. Autism. I haven't seen a child with autism that doesn't have a methylation problem when they were born. Oh. And usually it's a methylation problem and a severe copper deficiency. And then when they get exposed to the toxins, especially the vaccines, well, now you can't get them out because you can't detox right. When you get into this range, you're having a problem. This is what makes your urea, right? This is what you urinate out through the kidneys. It's controlled by arginine, so it also makes your nitric oxide. So over here, you can have problems with pneumonia, kidney stones, all the different problems with nitric oxide, which is a lot of circulation issues and neurological. This gets down in here to making some of your master antioxidants like SOD and a gland. There's GST again, which is again glutathione. So you're going to have problems with making antioxidants down here. And if it starts creeping up this way into the Krebs cycle, well, now you're going to have mitochondria issues, right? And you're not going to be able to make cell energy. So depending on what genes get turned off, you can have a lot of problems. And usually there's more than one. So when you start getting into the report, you can see here the genes that were turned off. The MTHFR. SULTs down here. So this is hormones, detox, gut. This is vitamin D receptors are getting turned off, probably because all that synthetic D. Mm-hmm. So right away we know, okay, you're not detoxing. So there's really five major systems I would talk about with methylation. Neurological. Where's my neurological? Gut health, cardiovascular health, reproduction, hormones, a lot of fertility problems, methylation. And of course, stone formations where the kidneys aren't working. So a lot of the oxalate problems where people are forming oxalate stones, well, that's over here in this range. A lot of these genes here, which connect these two, will form oxalate, where the person won't be able to break down the oxalates and they can form stones and problems. And that's where it gets confusing for people, because you're taking something that's supposed to be healthy for you. But if you don't have the enzymes to use it, then all of a sudden you start reacting.
Yes. I think that I spent probably, I don't know, $25,000 or so on supplements that probably, and supplements and detoxes that just went right to the waste system.
So you did have GAD, the GAD gene. So down here, GAD, that helps convert your glutamate. So you see people who will have problems with glutamate. And then a lot of people out there saying, oh, glutamate's awful for you, never take it. Well, your body makes it. It's not bad for you. The problem is if your body can't handle it right. Why? Well, you might have a gene turned off. Same thing happens up here and over here with, I think this one up here is the, what's the one thing that people like to take all the time? MSM.
Mm-hmm.
People who can't handle the MSM, that's some of these genes are turned off. And that gene's responsible for being able to break that down. So they will react.
Is that the C? Is it also, is MSM also CLO1? Is that the another name for it?
I think it's just one of the genes that control it.
Okay. Okay. Mm-hmm. I was curious because that was just one of the things that I tried. And yes, that made me ill.
Yeah. So you just never know.
Yeah.
And of course, the other big thing here on your scan. So when I saw the methylation, I knew, okay, that's part of the major issue. I would probably say all of this together, there was three major things. The weaponized pathogens, which you probably got when you got that bite. Mm-hmm. You have methylation genes that were being turned off. So that got to the point where you weren't able to detox. And who knows when that started, that might've been from the overconsumption of alcohol. And then the vitamin D and the body was like, okay, and genes start getting turned off. And then you get into the catch 22, where now you're not even able to detox. You have these weaponized guys who are attacking you. And then you're on the cell level with this unbound iron. You have this situation going on. Let's just look at the peptides, because peptides tell us usually how the weaponized stuff is attacking, because they make synthetic peptides. So they were going after your endocrine hormone, your neurological, and your vasoactive. Now, vasoactive is confusing because it's very long. They call it VIP. So in here, you'll notice it has to do with the stomach, the gallbladder, blood vessels, nerves, muscles. It controls a lot of different systems of the body. A lot of things that relax and contract are controlled by vasoactive. Intestines. So the VIP can be related to a lot of different processes in the body.
Wow.
And that's why they love going after your peptides, because then they can take over entire systems. Oh, there's another one up there, gastrointestinal. So they were actually going after the gut too.
Hmm.
So that's how we find out what the weaponized stuff was doing. So I have a whole training I did at the last Take on the World, to Take on the World 2022. So you just Rumble. And type in Dr. Monzo and you'll probably find Take on the World 22. I think my channel is called Truth, Health and Truth with Dr. Monzo or something like that.
I believe so. And we've been posting that on our Telegram's site also. So, which we will, I think we just posted it yesterday or the day before so that everybody could find it.
So that gets into the whole copper iron metabolism. Because what happens here is, it is up there. So when you get the copper iron metabolism, this stuff really hasn't been taught probably since the 30s. In the 30s, they knew very well. And then in the 40s, when the Nazis started working with Nephilim and demons to create the weaponized pathogens, they also changed the food supply and they started adding iron into the food supply and they started using pesticides. pesticides pull out copper. And then what they did is they started lying to all the doctors about iron copper metabolism. And they didn't teach them about true iron copper metabolism. I'm trying to talk and do something else at the same time. If I can bring up this one slide.
You're better than I am at it.
So, we're getting a little feedback on your end, Lee.
Is that me or you? Oh,
it's Lee. I'm hearing something.
Here we go. We're not going to go through all this, but the Matrix. We're just going to get to the good stuff. Red pill, blue pill. So, like I said, they changed the food supply and they started fortifying foods in the 40s. And what were they doing? They were adding iron shaving to your food supply. So when you see grains that say they're enriched or fortified, that means they added iron. And then they started adding synthetic B vitamins. They also started adding A, D, and iodine sometimes to the food. And then what happens, they took the iodine out when they realized it was good for you. And they replaced it with bromide. So all pesticides pull out copper. Now, the perfect copper chelator is glyphosate.
Wow. And
guess what one they use all the time?
Oh, yeah.
And then they started lying about fat. And it turns out your brain lives off of fat and copper. So there was an attack that began on iron, copper, and fats, and fat-soluble vitamins. D and A are both fat-soluble vitamins. Why did they start doing this? Why are they lying about it? Well, that gets into copper and iron I can't get into, but here's this slide. You have iron, which is red, red pill. Blue is copper, the blue pill. Copper is a mineral, looks blue. I think maybe on one of these other slides I had a, see that? Uh-huh. Those are blue copper crystals.
Wow.
So a lot of people only think of the metal, copper, but as a mineral, copper is blue, which really makes me wonder if they were not dyeing zeet seeds with copper.
Wow, yeah.
And by the way, the Hebrew word for copper, brass, and bronze are all the same thing. So what I find typically is everywhere where you have Yah telling his people to make something, it's talking about copper. Not brass, not bronze, because he's always using pure metals that are not mixed. Bronze and brass come from the same Hebrew root word because bronze and brass both need copper and other metals to make it.
Right.
They're not pure. So copper, gold, and silver can be 100% pure. So you have copper and iron. And you have this little protein enzyme called ceruloplasmin. Now, ceruloplasmin is needed to combine the copper and the iron together. But it needs retinol, which is animal-sourced vitamin A. Plant-based is beta-carotene. But beta-carotene doesn't work. You need animal-sourced, and it has to be clean animals. And then you also need magnesium. And that's why if you look at the ceruloplasmin, you see all these colors. The blue colors are the copper. The greenish-yellow, or actually the greenish colors are the retinol. The ceruloplasma is more of a yellow orange. And then the iron is the red and magnesium is kind of this dark reddish color in there. So all these come together to bind iron and copper metabolism. So it can get inside your mitochondria. So this is a mitochondria, which is your power station of the cell. And inside this mitochondria is blue lake. It's blue because it's copper. Huh. It's called the Matrix. That's right. That is what is called the Matrix inside your mitochondria. Wow. And it looks like these images from the Matrix, doesn't it?
It does.
Where this is a factory of humans being grown by machines. Same colors. Red pill, blue pill.
Yeah.
And so when these are bound together, your body makes energy. And what they didn't tell us is the machines are already in us, the nanotech. And what is it turning humans into? a copper top. Copper? They steal your copper.
You know, I recently did a show where I was looking at the two pillars on Solomon's porch and the fact that they were, it looks like the two witnesses, and they are covered with copper on the top. It's very interesting.
It is.
It's all there in Yah's word, isn't it?
Yes. So when you don't have enough copper, bioavailable copper, to bind up all that iron, it's called unbound iron, and unbound iron does not recycle. It gets stuck in your tissues and your cells. And when iron's stuck in your tissues and cells, it mixes with oxygen, and that causes oxidative stress, inflammation, mitochondrial dysfunction, and it starts turning off methylation genes.
Wow.
So why did they change the food supply in the 40s? Because they wanted to start turning off genes so people couldn't detox, but mainly they wanted to turn off those light-controlled genes so they could hide the nanotech and the weaponized stuff in the body. So they changed the food supply, and they started giving us all this iron and taking away your copper. And then they started lying to you about copper and telling you it's toxic when it's not possible. It controls too much. They start telling everyone you need iron, but here's the problem. How do they test your iron? The only real test for iron is your blood. Well, the problem is the iron is not in your blood. It's stuck in the tissues. They're not testing the tissues. So it only looks low in the blood, but that means it's really high in the tissues. And if your copper looks really high in the blood, it's really low in the tissues. Where do you want the copper? In the tissues. So you have this inverse relationship a lot of times with blood testing, which is why most of the time the blood testing is kind of a joke. Because even when they see what's in the blood, it's like, is it even supposed to be in the blood? That's the big question. And what does that really mean is going on inside the cell? Wow. Because what's going on in the blood is not an exact representation of what's going on inside the cell.
Yeah. See, that's a really good point. And I would have never thought of that except for hearing you explain it, you know?
Mm-hmm. And so what else is going on is, you know, they're lying about the type of fat we need. And that's because you need animal fat to make copper bioavailable. And there's a little copper lake in your brainstem called the locus coeruleus. Now, they've only started studying it in the last couple of years. That's Latin for blue dot. And guess what they found out? That blue dot is supposed to be full of copper, and it's supposed to deliver copper throughout the brain.
Wow.
And when that's not happening and heavy metals are building up in your brain, you're going to get oxidative stress, which is going to lead to Alzheimer's and Parkinson's and all these other issues. And what do we also see usually related to Alzheimer's and Parkinson's? High pesticide levels. What do pesticides do? Pull out copper. And that locus coeruleus also affects the part of the brain that has to do with anxiety and fear. In fact, copper is related to fear and anxiety.
Really?
Your magnesium is related to stress. Stress depletes your magnesium. Fear and anxiety deplete your copper. So what have they been doing for the last 3 years? Fear, anxiety, stress.
Yeah.
Because they don't want you to have mitochondrial energy. Because if your mitochondrial energy is down, then your cell is not going to work right.
Right. Right.
I have a question, Dr. Monzo. So you see a lot of people talk about drinking out of copper vessels and doing the copper water. Is that a benefit if you want to start slowly? I know in all your teachings, you say start slowly with the copper, or otherwise you'll make yourself very uncomfortable quickly. So is that something that we can do to start?
Yes.
On the basic level. Good.
Yeah. Cause your copper is gonna, your copper is gonna repair tissues, and it's also gonna start detoxing.
Very weird.
I'm looking at my PowerPoint, and I wanted to read something, and I'm realizing my PowerPoint is not complete. Like, all kinds of stuff disappeared.
Huh.
That's weird.
That's weird. I know one thing that, you know, as I was listening to you teach on something, one of the things that I had not thought about was that I thought I was doing so good by putting all my water through my Berkey, but not realizing that there were no minerals in it. You know, once it goes through the Berkey, that I needed to add back in some mineral drops to my water so that I would have minerals in it.
Yes.
Yeah.
There we go.
There it is.
I found the right one. So just look at this. Biological function. So copper. Copper increases energy, makes you smarter, heals nerves. You know, copper is what's used to help protect and make the myelin sheath on the nerves.
Wow.
Boosts mood, builds muscle, burns fat, converts cholesterol into testosterone, increases circulation, hair color. Copper is what provides dark skin and dark hair and red hair. If you have red hair, you need copper. If you have dark hair, dark eyes, you need copper. If you have dark skin, you need more copper. Copper is what gives the color. So it controls the melanin and it also controls the melatonin. And melatonin, you know, 90% of your melatonin is actually made in the mitochondria, not the pineal gland. Where is the copper going? Mitochondria that make energy. Prevents wrinkles, eliminates pain, is anti-inflammatory, heals joints, increases red and white blood cells. You need copper to make red and white blood cells. Boosts immunity, kills germs, improves a suntan, detoxes heavy metals and chemical toxins, helps with fertility. Yes. You know how many mitochondria is typical for the average cell? Over 500 mitochondria in one cell.
Wow.
The most in the body besides the brain is the female egg. The female egg can have up to 600,000 mitochondria in the egg. So if you're low in copper, guess what? Fertility is going to be a problem. You don't think they don't want us having good fertility, do you? Gives the body radiation protection, controls wow. hormones, endocrine glands such as the thyroid, because the thyroid is an oxygen center. What activates oxygen in the body? Copper. Helps the function of methylation. Nearly all of the top 20 causes of death involve copper deficiency. Copper actually cures all the symptoms of the top 50 drugs except for potassium. Copper needs two types of fats that become bioavailable: retinol and omega-3 oils from clean animals. So the brain lives off of fat and copper. So unfortunately, this whole vegan concept.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, people, you're getting misled in the vegan thing. Let me remind you, we were kicked out of the garden. I hear this phrase all the time, back to Eden, back to Eden, back to Eden is like a pansy hippie floating on the cloud idea. Oh, it sounds yeah. great, but the problem is you forgot you got kicked out and it's being guarded and you're not allowed back in.
Right.
He's right. going to restore us back to the garden. So why do you want to try to make it back into the garden now when it's not your authority to do so? Things have changed. We're not in the garden anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So we might want to think about that before we try to force our way back into the garden. And it's interesting that the only thing they were told not to eat from was a plant. It's like, so even the back to the garden's like, well, there's obviously some plants we weren't allowed to eat either. So are we going to figure that out? No, I think the answer is we're not supposed to be back into the garden until right. he restores all things. And that's his work, not ours. And then once he does away with sin and everything, then we're going to be back. But until then, we're stuck in this state where everything's different. And he told us that there were animals that were clean and animals that are not clean. So it's like, is there a reason why he did that? I think there might be a very important reason why. Now, of course, you want good grass-fed, grass-finished beef. If it's not grass-fed, it won't be high in copper. If it's grass-fed, it will be higher in copper and low in iron. If it's not grass-fed, it's going to be higher in iron and low in copper. So you want to make sure that we're eating not only biblically clean, but chemically clean, because that was the whole concept. But right. We have done a tremendous job absolutely poisoning our food supply, and now we are reaping the benefits of what we see because we've been all lied to and we're stuck in mystery Babylon. And so what happened is each generation is getting more toxic because all the toxins of the parents are being passed on, and our nutrients from the food are almost not even found in the ground anymore. So now we're passing on no nutrients to our kids. So, and we're trying to figure out, well, why is autism on the rise and all these problems on the rise? Well, if mother is deficient in copper, what's the child going to get?
Right.
Probably barely any copper. And then they might be born with methylation genes turned off. And then we want to inject them with every shot under, well, every shot that's probably from the pit of hell. And then we don't understand why their body can't handle all those toxins. It's like, so each generation is getting worse and worse because we're more toxic and we're more deficient of the minerals we need.
Yeah. Yeah.
But that's pretty much a good summary of the report. I mean, we could get into a lot of other things on the report, but I think that's really sums up what was going on with you. So to explain the last part, your 90% of your copper or 90% of your iron is supposed to come from a recycling system that's pulling the iron back out of the tissues and the cells back into the blood so it can get into the mitochondria to make energy, and it can get in the hemoglobin to help carry oxygen. That's why everything with the spike protein and COVID and the weaponized pathogens and 5G, they're all doing the exact same thing. They're shutting down your iron recycling system.
Wow, isn't
that
amazing?
Which is forcing the iron deep into your tissues, causing all of this inflammation and oxidative stress. Your energy crashes, and then what happens? You have your hemoglobin starts dropping oxygen. So what happens is that's not happening anymore. We're getting way too much iron from our food supply.
Right.
So only 10, or I think it's 95% is supposed to be the iron recycling system. Only 5% is supposed to come from our food.
You know, since I heard that from you, I've started looking at all the labels, looking for enriched or fortified, and making sure that it does not have those things on there.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And see, here's the other thing with that. When that's happening, you have oxidative stress building up in your cells and tissues because there's too much iron there reacting to the oxygen. And if you throw in other heavy metals like aluminum, which aluminum and iron mixed together causes instant oxidative stress, we call that rust.
Right.
Then your body is in this huge oxidative stress. So what the thyroid actually is doing, it's an oxygen sensor. And it's monitoring, it's the canary of the body, and it's monitoring whether or not you're in oxidative stress or hypoxia. But what is hypoxia? People have told us it's low oxygen. It's not low oxygen. Hypoxia is your body is not activating the oxygen. The oxygen's there, but your body has to activate it to be able to use it. And what does that? Copper.
Wow.
So the thyroid is sensing those things and then telling your liver, make more ceruloplasmin to get more copper into the cell to bind up all this iron so we're not in oxidative stress. Yeah. Or to release more copper so that we can activate our oxygen. So when you start having thyroid problems, the first thing we should not think of is, oh, we have all these metabolic and weight and blah, 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 blah. It's like, no, the first thing we should think of is you're under mitochondrial crisis. And that's why you're fatigued. And this is why people are fatigued and they think it's the iron is the problem. It's like, well, the iron is the problem, but it's not because it's low. It's because it's in the wrong place. So your body's not using it to make energy. So they start giving people iron. Short term, you're going to feel better. But then again, after a time period, you're just going to crash again.
Wow. So we do have a question here. Our friend Warwill is asking, how is low copper levels remedied? What's the best way to get started with that?
The best way for that is you could look at, where's that book behind me right open? Oh, I can't find it. Cure by Morley Robbins. He has a website called Root Cause Protocol. He explains most of this except for the spiritual aspects and the weaponized pathogens and how that relates. And his recommendations are very simple. Good old cod liver oil. because that's going to provide you your retinol. Grass-fed beef caps, they sell those. Now, my favorite company is Enviromedica. Enviromedica. They have grass-fed, grass-finished beef liver or beef organs. There's a product we sell here called IP6 Gold. IP6 Gold is anti-cancer, it's anti-everything, but it's one of the only substances that can pull out unbound iron.
Wow.
Usually, typically, the only way you can actually have real anemia is chronic blood loss. Blood loss is one way to get iron out of the body. This is typically why women are healthier, because they have a cycle and they're getting rid of iron every month. And then once they hit menopause, all hell breaks loose because you're not getting rid of the iron anymore. And you're just like us men who are just accumulating it. And the last study I think they did was like in the 60s. And they were saying we were accumulating 1 milligram of iron daily that we can't get rid of. So take your age times 365. Women are only supposed to have 4,000 milligrams and men are only supposed to have 5,000. Now, my guess, since they have nano oxide, nanoparticles, it's called oxide, no, iron oxide nanoparticles. They have magnetic iron oxide nanoparticles. They're spraying them like crazy now. So I bet we're gaining 2 or 3 milligrams of iron daily that we're not getting rid of. So IP6 Gold is one of the only ways I know of getting rid of it. That's a fiber that comes from grain. Probably why they want to destroy our grain.
Right. Right.
So you need a whole food type. So that helps get the iron out. Magnesium, most of your sources of magnesium are good. Now, when it comes to whole food C, you want whole food C. You do not want ascorbic acid.
Right.
The COVID cocktail is a killer. Who made it popular? Dr. Z. Dr. Z died of cancer. And everyone's now promoting his products.
Yeah.
Copper controls your zinc. Copper is the general. Copper controls your zinc and your iron. The reason why most people have a zinc deficiency is not because of the zinc. It's because the copper is too low. If you take too much zinc, it depletes your copper. Ascorbic acid, which was started by IBM in the 60s, how to pull copper out of the body by using ascorbic acid. Ascorbic acid is synthetic vitamin C. Everyone pushes it. But it wasn't made popular until the 70s by Linus Pauling, and he was funded by Rockefeller. And you know how they make ascorbic acid? They take high fructose corn syrup, and they mix it with hydrochloric acid, and it ferments in intestines. Whose intestines?
Ooh.
You know aspartate, that nasty synthetic sugar? You know how they make that? They take a chemical and they feed it to parasites, and the parasites poop it out.
Oh, wow.
You're eating parasite poop. What do you think they're doing with ascorbic acid? They're probably feeding it to some creature and it's pooping out fake ascorbic acid.
Wow.
You can't make this stuff up.
You can't make this stuff up.
It's not whole food. Whole food vitamin C has copper in it.
Wow.
Ascorbic acid does not. And then you have the D. Vitamin D is not a vitamin. It's a steroid hormone. And all I have to do for anyone out there who's a thinker is ask this question. Go look at what foods have D in it. There's not many, and it's very, very low. The highest is your cod liver oil. So here's my question. If D is so important for you, why didn't y'all put it in more foods?
Right.
Right.
Sometimes it's the common sense answer, isn't it? You know?
It's a hormone because your body makes it when you're exposed to light.
Yeah, absolutely amazing.
The high doses they're giving you is synthetic.
Hmm.
It comes from synthetic corn and different things that they feed sheep, and then they scrape the oil off the sheep fabric, and that's calorificol, vitamin D. It's synthetic.
Wow.
And the problem is they're testing it where? In the blood. This is what people don't understand. D. You have two types. Actually, there's 19 forms of D in the body that have been identified, and they're divided in two types. Active D and inactive D, which is called storage D. That's the 25D. That's the only one they measure in your blood. Guess what storage D does? Nothing. It's storage D. It's supposed to be in storage. And where is it supposed to be in storage? Fat and muscle. It's not even supposed to be in your blood.
Wow.
The active D is the one your body uses. They never measure it. So this thing about measuring your D levels and saying, oh, well, you're low, that doesn't mean anything. You're supposed to be low.
Wow.
Back in the 30s, they thought a number of 3 was normal.
Wow.
Because it's not even supposed to be in your blood. Your blood is a carrier. Blood is transportation.
Right.
The only time inactive D is supposed to be in the blood is when the body's carrying it somewhere so your body can turn it into the active form. So here's the question with the synthetic D vitamins. Show me a study where you measured all 19 forms of D to prove to me that that synthetic supplement actually improves the version you want. They don't have a study. So they're just assuming that taking a synthetic version is going to turn into the active form. But what we do know is when you take the synthetic form, it starts pulling calcium out of your bones. And it will start crashing your endocrine system and cause all kinds of thyroid problems, hair loss, palpitations. Yeah. Does that sound like post-COVID? Heart arrhythmia. That's a side effect of toxic high-dose synthetic D. Here's the thing people don't understand. It's a steroid hormone. It's not a vitamin. They call it a vitamin because they want you to take it. It's made by the pharmaceutical companies. Why do you think all doctors test for it? It is a steroid hormone. What does that mean? It's going to make you feel great because it's going to take away your inflammation because it's a steroid. But is it treating cause? Nope. Turns off your immune system. They know this. It does not boost the immune system. It turns it off. So what happens, people with Lyme and chronic diseases, they feel great on it because you know what you did? You turned your immune system off. You are covering up the symptoms with covering up the inflammation, but your body's not fighting anything. So you feel great. As soon as you stop taking it, inflammation's back and all those critters come out of the woodwork and your body's immune system comes back online and you feel awful because your immune system is trying to attack the invaders again.
Yes. I've lived that. I know that's true. Yeah. So we have another question if you have time. I've seen this one and one more. And so Nina is asking, is acupuncture cupping and gua shi the counterfeit of the Olive Tov system?
To some degree. There's some truth in those systems, but they can definitely be used incorrectly. They're as good as the practitioner. You get a new age witchcraft practitioner, you better be careful.
Absolutely. And then
the problem with the acupuncture too is when you're using needles in the body, you're forcing energy. Mm-hmm. The body's energy systems do not like force. That's why with Olive Tov body, you're using laying on of hands, very light touch on very specific points. We don't want to force the energy because you could cause a problem if you force energy. Like if you force it the wrong way.
And you can run into that in chiropractic also, correct?
Oh, yeah.
Yes. Yeah. It's better not to force the body. And that's what all these synthetic supplements and synthetic drugs do. So in my opinion, you know, I used to like the idea of functional medicine and everything. And then I finally just realized, you know what? Functional medicine is just like, instead of like taking a step out of hell, they just took a sidestep in hell. Because it's really just a bunch of medical doctors who gave up synthetic drugs for synthetic supplements. And it's like, they're still not naturally occurring. This is still not stuff that Yah created. This is stuff man created, and he thinks he knows better. Oh, let's make this high dose D and C, and it's going to be better. It's like, wait a minute. Did Yah create you to be able to eat a whole tree of oranges? No, you can eat maybe 2 or 3 oranges. Why do we think we can do it better than them?
Right. That's a great point. It really is.
And that's the biggest argument you will see with the synthetic C. Is people are like, well, I can't get a high dose. You don't need to, because it's 7 to 10 times more powerful when you have the whole vitamin C structure. Ascorbic acid is only one part of vitamin C. Yes. So when you're taking the synthetic version, you're missing the other 3 main parts of that molecule that's naturally occurring. So when you take the natural one, you don't need a high dose. Because there's more there that you don't get with the synthetic.
Right.
Not to mention you're missing all the frequency information that comes in the natural state which gives your body the software on how to use it. So you take the synthetic version, you get no software. So your body gets this synthetic chemical and it's like, what do I do with it? Yah's fingerprint's not on it.
Yeah.
You know, and what's sad, Dr. Monzo, is in nursing school, we spend about two, three weeks on talking about diet and minerals and how everything works. And we spend a whole semester on pharmacia.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm just sitting here just like, oh my goodness, if we had you, if we had that knowledge on the get-go, we, you know, it would have been exactly what a lot of us went into medicine to do, which was to help others, mm-hmm. you know, with health and well-being. But
this I see is the just question amazing. Too. Mm-hmm. I can see the questions on the screen. So someone wanted to know about prostate. Yes.
Yes.
Guess what? Wherever the copper accumulates, that's where you're going to have your problems.
Yeah.
Not copper. Iron.
Iron.
So the iron's accumulating in the prostate. That's why there's inflammation, most likely.
Yeah.
And it's the same thing with diabetes. Diabetes is on a rise. The weaponized stuff loves to steal your copper, to turn it into their own power supply, and all infections live off of iron. This is why hydroxychloroquine and ivermectin work, because when you look at their action, they pull iron out of parasites and microbes. That's what they live off of. If your iron's really high, you're going to have tons of infections. It starves them to death by pulling out their iron, and it actually helps improve copper in the tissues. So the whole action of ivermectin and hydroxychloroquine was not a zinc delivery system. It was a copper delivery system, and it was helping get rid of iron. But we don't need drugs to do that. But that's how you can explain why they were working. So they've had tons of studies to show that if you do take people with diabetes a lot of times and do iron chelation, the diabetes will go right away. And then they took people and they pumped iron into their pancreas. And you know what they developed? Diabetes.
Diabetes.
So they've known for a long time.
Wow.
And this is how the weaponized stuff has been working since the 40s, messing up your copper iron. And they just keep turning up the heat every time they release their new next nonsense on the world. And now it's the spike protein, which looks just like snake venom, and it looks just like hepcidin. Both of those shut down your iron recycling system. But doctors don't even know what they're looking at because they haven't been taught copper iron recycling. And then we just have to think back to the scripture. What did Moses make in the wilderness? A copper serpent. Why? Because people were being bit.
Wow.
By snakes. And copper stops the venom.
That's amazing.
What are we being bit by again?
Yeah.
The super spreaders are shedding all this snake venom that their body's making, because it's not actual snake venom. It's a synthetic peptide that looks like snake venom.
Yeah.
And they're shedding that on us. And our iron copper regulation is going crazy. And no one wants to talk about it because copper's toxic. It's like, come on, people. We need to get out of Babylon.
I know that you might be running out of time. So I did want to bring this one up from James. He's asking, how long does it take to get the results back from the Quest 4 once your samples are sent in? And is there a waiting list? I know you guys are very busy.
There is a waiting list. It's at the beginning of the year now, so it might not be as long as it was. But at one point, it was like 3 months, if not longer.
Right.
So getting the results back doesn't take long as we can get to the test.
Right.
But since there's a waiting list, it might take a couple months to get to the test. But usually when we do the test, it takes, like I said, an hour and a half, and you get the results of that day. So it's just a matter of getting in line to actually have the test done.
Yeah. And they can
because it's not automatic. And
right.
A lot of people don't know that. I have to physically sit here in front of the computer to run the test. So it's not like I can just hit a button and it spits out all the results, because you have to think through it. It tells you where to go and where to test. So every time I do a DNA, that's an hour and a half of my time. So it's not like I can just send it off to a lab somewhere. And that's the other benefit, is everything's coming directly to me and we destroy it when we're done. So You're not sending it to the government. You're not sending it to some lab who knows what they're doing with your DNA.
Yeah, and I see a test here. I mean, a question here. Nina's asking, is there a price sheet? That it is all online, and mm-hmm. there's contact buttons. And you know, if you're not able to find what you need, Jess at the front office has been very helpful and can help get you directed. So, you know, just go onto the website and poke around a bit, and you will find what you are looking for because it is all there.
Absolutely.
Okay. Well, gosh, this has been a great time together, Dr. Monzo. Did you have any final thoughts that you wanted to leave us with?
I don't think so.
Okay. I so much appreciate you taking your time to do this.
You're welcome. Yes.
It's wonderful.
We need to get the information out there.
We absolutely do. And I look forward to the next time that you're able to come back and join us. I know we're working on something, so we'll have to just see when that comes together.
Yep.
But I look forward to having you on again. And thank you, Lee, for joining us. And
thank you for letting me be here. It's absolutely love listening to Dr. Monzo. It's always just a wealth of information that my brain is going to have to process for the next couple of days.
Yeah, and if you go to the website and then contact us, you can get on a mailing list.
Yes.
I think our last newsletter just went out, but we usually always put the newsletters on the website. So I think we're announcing our next Alatop Body classes in March.
Yes. Yes,
and, that's all about teaching you how to use laying on of hands with the Hebrew letters. And it's very powerful.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm hoping that works out, that I can come and do that. And, you know, one of the other huge benefits of just being a client of the clinic is the Welcome Center and how much is available mm-hmm. and how many videos. I've been going through them slowly so that I can try to learn and understand more. And so there's just, I mean, I can believe how many resources are right there and how much work you've already done and information that you've put out there for people. So it's all, you know, available.
Yeah, and I have all those really old Alatop Body shows.
Yes.
Which I recorded, that was like 2014, 2015.
So yeah.
It seems like they're outdated, but when you go back and listen to them, they're really not, because they're just based on Yaz principles.
I was listening to your one on methylation last night. You did it in 2016, and it was one of the old radio shows. Yeah. But I mean, I learned a tremendous amount, and it's just as valid right now as it was in 2016.
Yeah, there's some good stuff there.
Yeah. All right. Well, with that, I think we're going to go ahead and wrap up and say shalom to everyone. We pray this has been a blessing to you, whether you were able to join us and watch it now or whether you're watching it later. And we wish you good health. All righty. Thank you, Dr. Monzo. Thank you, Lee.
Thank you.
Bye-bye, everyone.
You can see it in the movies and the paper and the TV news. Somebody's army is always on the move. There's gonna be a battle, the lines have been drawn. They got guns and tanks and planes. The wells are gone dry and the water is bad, and the air is acid rain. There's war after war and rumors of war from the east. There's a rumbling in the ground, and they're talking about